We just give the next speaker a couple of minutes to join, but I can probably start to integrate to present. So the next speaker is going to be, I hope I'm pronouncing this correctly, Shweta Sabner. I may be wrong, I'll be honest. Did I pronounce your name correctly?
Yes, you did.
Good. How are you doing today?
I'm good. Thank you so much for having me here.
Very good. We're happy to have you on stage. We are in perfect time, so I'm going to be leaving the stage to you. And Shweta is going to be, you know, she's a principal engineer at Shutterstock. It's the image platform.
Correct.
All right. Yeah, I remember correctly. And so she's going to be talking about how to build an easily integratable APIs. So the stage is all yours. I'm going to get out of the way and enjoy the presentation.
Do you guys see my screen? Hello, my name is Shweta Sabni, and I've been a software engineer at Shutterstock for the last 4 years. For those of whom you don't know, Shutterstock is a leading global technology company, and we offer high-quality assets, tools, and services through our creative platform. In our two-way marketplace, we have nearly 1.9 million active customers from over 150 countries and over a million contributors across 100 countries. So it's imperative for us to, you know, continuously improve our user experience, improve our user engagement, and make our products and platforms sticky. Today, I'm going to talk to you about some of the engineering strategies that Shutterstock's developer platform team has implemented to build easily integratable APIs and improve user engagement. So let's start by understanding what is Shutterstock's developer platform. As an engineer on this team, our commitment is to ensure that Shutterstock's assets and technologies are made seamlessly available to our partners. We offer a suite of tools, you know, such as the REST APIs, which is also called as our Shutterstock API, SDKs, and Shutterstock UI, which is a widget. And these tools are intended to allow ease of asset discovery and asset licensing. In addition to these tools, we also have machine learning products and algorithms that are made available to our partners over the REST APIs via our computer vision services. So like I said, our mission is all about making our content and technologies available outside of our website, which is shutterstock.com. With the Shutterstock public API, we are integrated into thousands of digital platforms, including Facebook ads, Google, Microsoft, etc. For example, Facebook uses Shutterstock's REST API to explore Shutterstock's images and build their native ads workflow. Similarly, Google's responsive display ads are empowered via Shutterstock's REST API. Magic Leap is another partner, and they use our API to empower their spatial computing products. Now, while these are some of the big names, in total, we have over 6,500 integrations in production today. And the journey to achieving these numbers has been multifold. In addition to paying attention to customer requests, technical evolutions, and rolling out new and exciting features in time, I'm hoping to share some of the important yet simple engineering strategies that we implemented over the last couple of years to make our developer platform experience easy to our users and increase the traffic to our APIs. So some of the items we're going to talk about today are improving documentation, making API exploration easy, SDKs, sandboxes, customization of products, content discovery, and Shutterstock UI. Let's get started with improved documentation. How many times have we landed on, you know, documentation pages of various SDKs and APIs only to be stumped by the copious amounts of information there? There have been instances where the docs, the getting started page on the docs or the sample application has been easy. But when it actually comes to production level integration, finding the right tools, the right integration points has always left us helpless. In our research, we found that integrating with OAuth mechanisms especially has always been the toughest part of building integrations. And honestly, that was quite the state of our docs until a couple of years ago as well. We kept on receiving the same questions and queries via our support helpline and on Stack Overflow. So in our journey to make Shutterstock API easy to use, we realized that fixing our documentation was paramount. API documentation serves an important role in marketing an API solution. And in our case, we could broadly classify two types of users who would take a look at a documentation. There were business decision makers who were interested in knowing the extent of our content. And then there were developers who were ready to start using this API in building out their integration. So it is important that we logically structure out our information in such a way that it was not noisy to either of the groups. Additionally, clear API documentation not only shows, you know, what the user can do with the API, but also how easy it is to integrate. And for that, it was very important to have clear command and response examples, also including the exact response models, error messages. The format of error messages in a concise form is proven to be especially helpful. Having code examples especially made it easy for developers to build integrations because all they could do is just copy-paste the example into their application, change some configurable values, and it would work right out of the box. So ultimately, we were focused on giving developers a what you see is what you get type of experience when they looked at our documentation. But it's also not just enough to have strong documentation, right? Like updating the documentation has always been a bigger challenge. We have to always ensure that there is complete parity between the REST API, the functionality that our API does, and the associated documentation and references. In order to do that, we decided we are going to start treating our docs as code. To further achieve that, we realized that it's quite easy if we publish our API interface or if we publish our API documentation using the OpenAPI spec. So that was the first thing we did, is to write our API interface using the OpenAPI spec. Then we decided to keep our documentation code alongside our application code wherever possible. What that meant is every time there were changes to the documentation code, it underwent the same processes as an application code would undergo, which is issue tracking, prioritization, code reviews, et cetera. And finally, we ensured that the documentation deployment pipeline is same as the application deployment pipeline. So I'm going to take a moment to sort of deep dive into this whole process of how we achieved auto-generation of documents. As you can see on the right side, this looks like an unresolved JSON API spec, which is what it is. In fact, it's not even an open API spec at this point. It's just an unresolved JSON doc. And like I said, we decided to publish our interface using open API spec mainly for three reasons. A, it is an industry standard. B, it's quite flexible, and C, that there are a lot of open source tools available that operate on the OpenAPI spec. So for example, when I speak about flexibility, OpenAPI spec provides this capability of having extensions. And what that means is if you have any field in the spec that starts with X hyphen, it means that it's a customized field that the developer is applying to the spec. So we used Xcode examples as an example to publish examples. I said examples too many times. But that's the first step in our auto-generation document auto-generation pipeline. Next, what our pipeline does is takes this JSON file and converts it into a resolved OpenAPI spec. Now, as you can see here, the examples are flushed out, the URL is correct. And then we take this resolved OpenAPI spec and pass it to Widdershins. Widdershins is another open source tool that we decided to leverage. It works seamlessly with OpenAPI spec, Swagger 2.0, and I think it also works with RAML. I'm not too sure. But what Widdershins does is converts your spec into a markdown. Widdershins also works with custom templates. So for example, we could configure our Widdershins to tell the tool that, look at the Xcode examples field in the OpenAPI spec and use that to generate code samples. So what our pipeline did is configured Widdershins, converted the OpenAPI spec into a markdown. Then we take this markdown and give it to Shins. Shins is also another open source tool that converts your markdown into an HTML documentation. Our pipeline then saved this HTML documentation into a temporary file, which was later on post-processed. At this stage, we just fix synthetic issues, add our logos, fix our fonts, things that further make your HTML document pretty. And finally, it was this HTML document that got deployed. And the deployed document looks like this. So we went from a very, if I can say, ugly looking JSON file to this beautiful API reference page, all hands-free in an automated manner. And we could do that because the source of truth of our document and the source of truth of our API functionality is the same, which is the OpenAPI spec. Since we improved our documentation, we saw a distinct drop in the kind of questions we kept seeing, especially on Stack Overflow, around how do I use a particular endpoint? What sort of query parameters does it support? Does it work with PHP as an example? So this was our first step that was successful in making integrating with our API easy. The second strategy that we explored and built upon was making API exploration easy. Different developers need different levels of information. Some might be trying out a simple scenario like searching for an image, while others may be planning or implementing large-scale integration. So the best way to familiarize yourself with any API is ultimately to take it for a test drive. We wanted to ensure that our developers and our partners also had an easy way to do that. And since we already used OpenAPI spec, generating this API Explorer page was quite easy. What we did was, with this API Explorer page, what our partners and developers could do was now come here, plug in their API key, and try out individual endpoints. This is especially helpful for devs who wanted to see all of our endpoints in one place and who wanted to track variations that our endpoints undergo, say deprecation of certain query parameters, changes to response models, et cetera. And in general, for devs who were more comfortable working with Swagger specs, we built this option keeping them in mind. However, the most effective solution that we implemented in terms of making API exploration easy was releasing Postman collections. Almost all devs who have worked in web application know what Postman is. It's a tool that allows you to explore APIs with live calls and streamlines your development. The best part of Postman is it can convert your sort of raw curl request into various other programming languages. So say there is a developer who is writing code in a particular programming language that we have not yet published on our documentation. They could basically get that by using Postman. Again, all they have to do is download this collection, change certain configurable keys, and the collection just works out of the box. The third thing that, again, ties back to our OpenAPI spec strategy, but we rolled out to make integration with Shutterstock API easy was releasing SDKs. This actually came to us as a result of direct requests from our current users. So we decided to explore what an SDK would be for us and release that out. So ultimately, it is a little friendly JavaScript code, and it's friendly than accessing the API directly because it is more readable. So people can just call functions like search images or license videos instead of actually constructing URLs to the API endpoint. It also made integrating with Shutterstock API easy because now devs don't have to, use a separate HTTP request library and spend time integrating other packages. And ultimately, SDK keeps your code up to date with the latest API features and ensures that, your code is accessing the API correctly. Again, like I mentioned, because the source of truth for our application is OpenAPI spec, we realized that we could quickly leverage on that to also auto-generate our SDKs. So if you look at how we do that, again, we start with that ugly looking JSON file, which is an unresolved OpenAPI spec. And we realize that there is a lot of open source tooling out there to convert an OpenAPI spec into a JavaScript SDK. We really wanted to use one of those tools, which was Swagger CLI CodeGen. But in our research, we found that that particular tool works well with Swagger 2.0 and doesn't necessarily quite well with OpenAPI spec itself. So the next step that we had to do in our SDK auto-generation was convert our OpenAPI spec to Swagger 2.0. And again, we did this by using another open source tool called OpenAPI Spec Converter. And finally, the Swagger 2.0 version of the documentation was passed on to Swagger CLI CodeGen that auto-generated our SDK. So this, again, by using OpenAPI as the source of truth, we were able to auto-generate SDKs without any manual intervention. I know I've said OpenAPI spec a lot, and I do want to take a moment to highlight its power as it applied to our Shutterstock API. Our build pipeline became very easy and was like all stages of the pipeline or all of our tools remained in complete parity with each other because we used OpenAPI spec. As this flowchart illustrates, every time we deploy Shutterstock API, our build pipeline then asks the question, has the spec itself changed? And if the spec has changed, we regenerate our documentation, we regenerate our reference pages, we regenerate our SDK code, and deploy each of them. And that allows us to ensure complete parity between the functionality of our API and associated tools. So again, OpenAPI has been increasingly helpful for us and very beneficial for us to ensure that, again, devs could integrate with our API quite easily. The next strategy that I want to talk to you about is customized products. And this is kind of a mixture of, tech and product organization coming together to make user experience easy. So like I've been saying, Shutterstock caters to different types of users and partners. And all users don't need access to all offerings at all times. Hence, to address users' needs based on their requirements, we worked out on building custom products. We built out streams of our contents and classified our content into differing asset tiers. Our search and discovery teams then further worked on making these asset tiers individually discoverable and licensable. We rolled out solutions that would allow flexible access to these individual groups of products. So as you can see on the screenshot here, every time a developer goes on to sign up for an API key on our platform, they get provided options to pick which type of product they want to apply or associate with their API key. Furthermore, if based on the level of integration of the developers, you know, whether they are an individual developer or whether they are an enterprise partner, we also assign attributes to their application to adjust their rate limits. This level of flexibility has ensured that we don't alienate users who are not yet prepared to, say, make a certain revenue commitment. And finally, we launched new type of e-commerce subscriptions that would allow you to, you know, directly access API to license your assets, but also allow them to be resold. With these sort of product and tech coming together and providing customized solutions allowed us to have at least a 30% increase in new user integrations. The next step that we realized we had to undertake to make our make using our API easy was rolling out Sandbox. So like I said, Shutterstock offers diverse e-commerce products to our users. Most of our users can then use these e-commerce products and then license our assets. Our RESTful API also offers endpoints to license these assets by using the associated subscription of these products. Naturally, the act of licensing an asset is revenue impacting. Every time an asset is licensed, we deduct a customer's subscription credits. So for customers who want to test out their licensing integration, but don't necessarily want to use the licensed assets, we decided to offer them the Sandbox capability. The primary function of Sandbox, therefore, is to allow developers to test their licensing requests without incurring any costs. And they could do that by simply pointing their integration to api-sandbox as opposed to api.shutterstock.com, which is the production version of our application. The difference between production and sandbox, there are two main differences. The first one is there is no charge, so your subscription credits are not getting deducted. And the second difference is instead of giving you the actual asset that you want to license, we just return a dummy asset to you. But again, it was very important to ensure that our sandbox functionality remained 100% in congruence with the production functionality, because ultimately what we wanted our developers to do is just switch the URL and that's it. They shouldn't have to rewrite their integration code when they decided to move from sandbox to production. And we achieved that by using this sort of request flow. Every time a request to license an asset came into our gatekeeper or proxy, we asked the question that, is this pointing to sandbox? If it was, we appended a custom sandbox header. We then took this request and sent it down to our Shutterstock API deployed application code base. This request is then pre-processed, we perform validations, and at this point we check if the sandbox header is present or not. If it is present, it means that the developer is just trying to, you know, test out an integration. They don't want their subscriptions to be deducted. So we just do that. We don't deduct anything and return a dummy URL. Otherwise, you know, they're actually in production environment and therefore we make them go through the whole licensing process. So just by using a proxy and by using a simple if-else type of check within our application code base, we were able to offer our partners 100% congruence between production version versus the sandbox version of the application. The last two strategies that I want to talk to you about that made our API easy to use was building content discovery tool and Shutterstock UI. So as we previously discussed, there were two types of users who explore our developer platform. Content discovery tool was made keeping the business decision makers in mind, the ones who are coming to evaluate our assets and who want to sort of see our API in action. As you can see here, you know, a developer can come in, they can compare different types of asset tiers. They can, in fact, even plug in their API key here and compare the extent of, you know, the access they have to other content tiers, etc. This is also an easy way for the developers to see the API in action and at the same time explore our asset library. This is also made keeping our sales stuff in mind, you know, so that it was easy for them to go ahead and explain and help our new partners and new integrations to understand how Shutterstock API works. And finally, the last sort of tool that we released was Shutterstock UI. It's actually a widget. We call it Shutterstock UI. It allows a user to build a customizable search interface. And with that, they can go live with their Shutterstock integration within hours. What it basically does is it delivers a ready-to-use code snippet. And it is designed to cover majority of user workflow scenarios for asset search. At the same time, the developer can provide customization options to tailor the Shutterstock integration for their own needs. In fact, the content discovery tool that we saw in the previous slide is a perfect demonstration of Shutterstock UI. Imagine, so it basically becomes this ecosystem where we have the content discovery tool that uses Shutterstock UI that is backed by Shutterstock API, all working seamlessly. In fact, in order to make the use of Shutterstock UI even easier, we rolled out this Wizards of Sorts. So now what developers have to do is come here, fill in their configurable options like title, subtitle, or alter their, you know, callback URLs, even plug in their API key. And with a click of a button, they get this code, either in HTML or React. And then they can just copy paste this code in their own application. And bam, this beautiful looking search and asset discovery toolkit is made available to them. So thus, we did all these changes. And we wanted to make sure that they actually made integration with our API easy. We needed to capture numbers. And we did that. And we found that it actually made a difference. After rolling out these changes, we saw a 56% increase in the site traffic to our developer portal. And we saw a 60% increase in new partner engagements. So thus, to conclude, we made our API easy to use by making efficient use of OpenAPI spec and open source projects such as Widdershins and Shins to build world-class documentation. We then leveraged the same spec to auto-generate SDKs to make coding with our API easy. We built a playground or sandbox of sorts that allowed users to test out financially impacting transactions of the API at no cost. We continuously monitored user feedback, observed usage patterns by drilling into our analytics data. And with these insights, we were able to offer customized products to our users. And finally, we built Shutterstock UI to make it super easy for our partners to build impressive and customized asset discovery using our API. I hope these simple but efficient strategies have been valuable to you. I look forward to your thoughts, opinions, questions, etc.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Shweta. I don't see any question here on the stage chat, but I have two of them, if you can answer. So the first one that I've been noticing in your talk, you were saying, in order to generate the SDK, you were converting your OpenAPI 3 file into the OpenAPI 2 and then passing through the SDK. I was wondering, did you get any problem or missing informations or, you know, something was lost during all those conversions?
Right. So we saw loss of like custom example fields. For some reason, Swagger CLI CodeGen was not able to work with the extensions that we had. That was the main reason, though. And when that didn't work out, we realized we had to convert back to Swagger 2.2.
Okay, understood. And then the second question that I have, it's always on the SDK generation. Like one of the points that I always hear is that if we auto-generate the code, most likely, you know, maybe this library, the SDK generated, is handling the error in a different way that my application is doing. It's not retrying, or it's using an HTTP client that is not good enough. And I was wondering, you know, did you get any kind of those problems? What do you suggest to the customers? You know, if you have any kind of an insight on that.
So the first part of your question, if I understand correctly, is the error handling scenario.
It is one of the things, like, you know, right. The SDK is going to handle the error in a way, but maybe the strategy I'm using in my company is completely different. That's
right. So
what do you do?
Like, again, it all goes back to the OpenAPI spec that we published. And we basically have our responses extended for every single error scenario that the endpoint throws. And that automatically gets translated to the SDK code as well. And therefore, that gets published on the SDK documentation. That if the API returns anything that is non-200, it is going to throw an error. And if you want to handle that error, you need to wrap it in a try-catch block, for example.
Okay. So essentially, you know, the handling of the error is up to the user. The SDK is going to tell you, you know, yeah, there is an error. Now do what you want.
And right. And we had to do that because in some cases, like for platform partners who are, say, working across in the APAC time zone or in APAC region, the response times they get to actually download the asset is slightly higher than the response times for users in US. So we don't want them to, we want them to be able to retry, and we, this is the solution we tell them is to, you know, if you want to add a retry mechanism, handle your errors.
Yeah. All right. So basically, let's not be too opinionated. The user will make the final decision. I totally agree with the strategy here.
Yep.
All right. I think that's all. We're in perfect time. Thank you very much for being